Hey, welcome to the November 2016 Poetry and Music Salon at Palmerston Library. I'd like to welcome you all to Palmerston Library Theatre, and I would like to thank two wonderful women, the librarian, Iana Georgieva Kaluba, and the branch manager, Misu Hedman, for this great location for our Poetry and Music Salon. So these salons are a gift to all of you and to the thriving poetry and music community in Toronto. We're all here to support each other, to be the best we can all be, and to support each other's creativity and each other's work. And in that spirit, we'll be welcoming people and making, talk to the writers. And I hope you're inspired to go home and do some writing or compose another song as well. We've got some really great features today. Lisa de Nikolits and Steve Paul Sims is the musician. And Alexandra Innes is our guest poet. She knew Leonard Cohen, so she's been invited as a special guest, especially to read some of her Leonard Cohen poems. Next is Anna Geisler, and I know her through Guernica. She's just an incredibly supportive and hardworking member of Guernica Editions Publishers. And turns out she's a fantastic writer herself, so I'm really happy to have her out today and to welcome her to Palmerston Library series.
Hey everyone, my name's Anna Geisler. Brenda, thank you so much for inviting me here. I've been meaning to make it out for the past couple months and I finally did, so I'm super happy I'm here. I'm just gonna read a couple of recent poems. The first one is called Binoculars. The pink man who kept a weasel on a leash would sit outside his stucco house, losing pigment in the sun and gathering gossip. We called him Lorneta, Binoculars. Aunt Bassa and I would take turns giving him news that crawled like wild weeds into our ears, out of purses and cellars, from stoves and bathtubs, from the neglected corners of our neighbors' mouths. That summer was hot and acrid, and we longed to go to Schlesien Beach to put our toes in the scraggly water. The air hung drier every day. The grass crept to the shade. Aunt Basha and I carried leather flip-flops and saggy bathing suits in our shoulder bags. We had skinny arms and legs, but how quickly we grew. On the last day of summer, the sky darkened. We ran towards the house from the bus station. It rained. Lorneta flashed us a glance, and we could have sworn he would crash like thunder down the street. We hid in the bathroom all evening that day. We sleeked our frizzed hair with butterfly clips. I wanted to cool off in the shower and found a cockroach on my towel. Aunt Basha washed it down the sink with scalding water, and stunned, I wondered, will it come back up? It won't, she said. Only people do that. Melodies. In the thin whistle of a train that passed through the station without stopping, I hear Aunt Christina defeathering a white hen in her courtyard in the shadow of a heap of clouds. Dry concrete, a praying box of marguerites, and the shiny blade cooling off on a stump of brick. The stick feet work as a metronome, going up and down as she plucks the body against her body. She's in tune with the rhythm of the wind, knocking on the tin shed, the buzz of the power lines that stretch around her yard, the lazy mules of cats plugging holes that are too costly to fix. She plucks without losing tempo and without getting carried in the swell of a moment's pleasure that rises and loafs before hungry eyes. Even the clouds drop from the sky, like a pair of trousers, bearing what's underneath. To this, Aunt Christina looks up, unconcerned, at the lowering tray of mist, and the hen doesn't squirm or cackle, just flex to her loosened fist. She is at once queen and carcass, The thought of this leaves me swelling like a balloon, and I lift up in song. And this last poem I'm going to read is called I Like to Steal, and it's a bridging title, so the first line is also the title. I like to steal. Time mostly, but also the early days of marriage, sheltered between lectures and part-time jobs, forgotten holidays, All Saints Day is a good one, and also sleep on the couch in daylight. When I steal, at least I know I won't get caught in the crowded joy of others and the laughter that they force on me. A thief here today or anywhere, if I can help it. Thank you.
Isn't she terrific? It's so wonderful to get to know this whole other side of somebody, and really like your poetry. Next up is a very talented lady, Ilyana, who's going to be playing as well as reciting.
Just playing.
Just playing, wow. So she's a poet and photographer and musician.
So I'm a musician from Ireland, and unfortunately I'm leaving Canada in December to go back to Ireland for a few months. And I've never played a gig in Toronto before, but I have just managed to get one at the Free Times Cafe on December 16th. Hooray. So if anybody is free, I would really like to see you there.
So this song is called Cover. It's not a cover, it's actually a song.
Someone
time, and my body will be buried wrapped in silk, encased in gold.
So most of my poetry is tinged and soaked with sadness. And, the first one is called The Heart Does Break. And it came to me after I glanced over the title of a book, which is the same, The Heart Does Break. Say what you will, I still maintain that the heart does break at life's defeat. So let me repeat, the heart does break. But what I find inconceivable, absurd, is how in spite of such ordeal, detached from the mind and cut off from the mind and the world, it still remains in place, beating without cease, and how the body, still like a shrewd, high-lick machine, switched on from within, unhinged from loss and pain, will whinge and claim its meal in its fair share of rest, while the soul, hurt and forlorn, unable to the best, wanders on. This next one I wrote after I had a brief conversation with a friend, telling her how difficult it was for me to look after a home now on my own, so many things to get fixed and look after. And one particular thing I said is, I need to replace a door, and I don't know how to go about it. And she said to me, well, so there you go, write about doors. And I thought, what? But then I went home, back home, and I started thinking. And I wrote, I've been dreaming about doors and nightmaring all the while, because my old abode and I ready seem for a new one. I've been searching near and far, and I see many a door, cordial doors, just like a heart, to love receive and love impart. Doors that shout welcome high, doors that cry a sad goodbye. doors which dear ones cross no more, gone forever from our side. Doors that keep lovers apart or discreetly tucked inside. Doors that open to the light that she's reaching for the stars. Open doors always to hope. Doors to lock the pain within. Oh, the many doors I've seen. The wrong ones, the one just right. Getting old I am, I guess, and not keeping with the times. But dear me, prices are vile. All the while salesmen would press on the high. Alas, decide. Well, I know they think me cheap, but my pockets are not deep. And all I want is a simple door, one which safely does its task without having to impress, one to seal away the drafts, and that maybe, oh, just maybe, will protect me from riffraff. I do fear you'll judge me amiss, but it really comes to this. Buying a door is a serious thing for a pauper or a king. And if I must humbly confide, given quality and price, all I want is a bleeding door, not the gates to paradise.
Featured her early in the series when it was at Urban Gallery. She's a wonderful woman, and I just love the connection.
Thanks.
So thank you very much, and Emilio.
Timely and tidy in taking the places, the instruments tune to their trebles and basses, as fluttering hearts rush or flush with their faces, with everything rightly sad. Gracing the stage in a glistening glow, as the curtain is drawn to get on with the show, with the tap of the toe and the swish of the bow, he goes rising up and rolling over, playing the minuet. The sun arcs akimbo, the clouds billow by, the moon sways severely, the stars pirouette, the wind moves the seas and the trees on the fly, in step with the shadow of his silhouette. The woodwinds with gusto establish the story, the brass etch the edge to embolden the glory, and zinging the zing with the strings to the score, he goes rising up and rolling over, painting the minuet. Ba-da-da. Casting the charms in the lime of the light through the gloom of the room, still and solemn as night, with the blank velvet stares of nobody in sight, and yet harboring no regret. Mellow, profound by the music possessed, every finger so nimble, each note finely stressed, and as with the cadence it all comes to rest, he goes rising up and rolling over, dancing the minuet. Rising up and rolling over, dancing the minuet.
Thank you, Emilio. So I know him from the art bar. He does a lot of open mic there, and he's an incredible spoken word and poet. You should hear him sometimes. He can speak faster than an auctioneer. And now, you know, here you are singing. I love it. It's fabulous. So Hannah and I connected on Facebook, and this is her first time. reading or performing, I'm not sure exactly. You're on open mic. Oh, come on up. And so we'd like you to welcome
I always used writing to get my thoughts out when I felt like I couldn't speak my mind and I didn't know who to talk to or who to turn to. Recently, a lot has been just kind of blowing up in my life and I didn't know where to go. I've realized now that I have an amazing support system. It's like one of my really close friends in the back, he came. Thank you, Pierre. So I stopped writing for a few months and tried to just figure myself out. And a few days ago, I didn't have a class, so just sitting there trying to do some work and I couldn't think for the life of me. I was just really confused and there's so many thoughts coming into my mind and I was angry and I was sad and it was just all over the place. And then I just started kind of writing. And I sat there for a good 2 hours just writing everything that was in my mind. And I ended up with what I'm going to speak today. So what's here is really raw, it's unedited, it's an exact representation of my mind and my thoughts in that moment. So also just like a side note, there's a lot of tongue twisters and English is not my first language, I'm not super good at that, so I might mess up a few parts. So it's about my dad. Him and I have been going through a lot recently, and he's been my rock, so, yeah. I haven't written in a long time, but something inside is making me pour out the way that I feel. Welcome to the small piece of my heart and soul that wants to be opened up, a representation of disaster. The calm, the storm, the flood, the depths, the disaster-stricken repercussions of my decisions. I'm tired of telling myself it's all going to change, and I just haven't felt the same. Stopping everything seems like such a safe bet, and everything is so hard, and I'm so alone. Now in this moment, when I look over, I see that tomorrow's my father's birthday, the father of the man who taught me who I am today, the one person in this life I never wanted to disappoint. He'd always say, be his little girl. But I'm not daddy's little girl anymore. I'm so sorry, father, and I love you. I never thought I'd become who I am today, turning into someone like you. In these moments, I feel so alone, alone with my thoughts, left alone to make decisions I shouldn't have to make alone, and I'm so sorry for not listening to your advice. You always told me to pick my poison, but mine is destroying me, and I'm sorry. Daddy's little girl grew up, and she saw the world. The world is a horrible place, Father. There's a little bit of humor in this mess that I like to call life. Now, the humor in our situation is our similarities. You and I, Father, we are the same. We follow the same path, we always end up in the same place, and our mistakes control us because they are our escape. We escape to these mistakes because they wait patiently for us, but ours will set us free. Now here I was, just shy of 16, seeing the world with new eyes, eyes I never thought I'd get, seeing the world like you. You've always taught me to get back up when I fall, that I've fallen and I need your help to get back up. I haven't seen you in months. I just want to talk to you, have a conversation, drive down the highway like we used to. You were my rock, and now I've fallen at sea and lost track of who I want to be. Now all that I feel I've got left is breathing in that cigarette smoke you told me to stay away from. That's the only way that I feel closest to you. My emotions made me feel numb, and the only time I have feeling is when I'm hurting myself, because pain seems to be the only thing that I can feel right now without my constant, my best friend, my rock, holding me together. I miss you. It's a constant collapse, it's a vicious cycle of my mind spiraling downhill every second, every minute, every hour of the day. Everything is getting uncontrollable. I listen to our favorite song. It sings asking if we traded our heroes for ghosts, hot ashes for trees, and yes, Father, I did. This song is what keeps you close to me, and as tears stream down my face, I feel this odd settling feeling of comfort and being hopeless. And there's a bit of hope in the holes in the distance that are far from my reach, and I miss you. But you are free, and you can thrive without me, and that's my happiness. Looking back at my childhood, I was always angry, thinking you needed to change, but I realized without you that it was I, in fact, that needed to change. I needed you, and I'm sorry. But thank you for teaching me and setting me free. Now, in situations like today, I need you most. But there's a lesson to learn that I won't crash and burn, and I'll push through these moments and rise above, and you understand. You always understood. Now, mental illness is no joke, and in some moments when I crash, it feels like the world is falling down. I may be underwater, but sometimes you catch me before I fall. Other times I'll swim away and suffocate my mind to try and feel life. You held on to religion, but I lost my faith. Father, your God is a fraud because he's never helped me find a new light. But I'm here and I'm trying. So let's scream till you're gone, till we cough up blood. Let the rain will fall and we will survive this flood. Because I am whole, I am clean, but I am not free, Father. We just have to breathe. Please pull me to my feet. Now sometimes I feel like nothing, and sometimes my thoughts swallow me whole and destroy me. Some days it's hard to get out of bed, but you always pushed me. You pushed my limits and taught me to push myself till I am incapable. Some people may say that's toxic, but I'll see it in a way that'll always help me grow. It's a mess to rearrange my thoughts and what's in my mind, and somehow it just always. Father, I promise it will always fall into place.
Thank you so much, Hannah. And it's always wonderful to welcome people who have never stepped up in front of an audience to share the depths of their selves in their poetry. So it's wonderful. Luciano is a publisher of Quattro Books. Come on down, Luci.
Okay, just trying to figure out.
Yeah. He's launching a book published by Guernica this year called The Examined Life. And there are poems in dialogue with philosophers. It's a really interesting book, and he's launching December 4th, the same time I am, which is a week tomorrow.
Yeah, very excited to be launching with Brenda, Georgieva, Clark, and a couple of other people. Anyways, this is my tattered copy of The Examined Life, and as Brenda said, it's sort of a book that riffs with philosophy and philosophers, and the poem I'm going to read today is sort of like a tribute to Pythagoras. Interesting thing about Pythagoras, he had a school, a sort of a cult actually, and there were a bunch of dietary rules that he had, and one of them was to not eat meat, and the other one was to not eat beans. And so this takes that rule and plays with it a bit. So my tribute to Pythagoras. The earth is a cube surrounded by six tetragons, each of which separates into eight triangles, and beans were the first things to emerge from the triangular ground. But do not eat beans, do not eat them. It's an insult to the universe. From the right hand of the universe comes motion. From the left hand comes matter. There is a void outside the universe into which the universe exhales. But do not eat beans. Do not eat them, lest the universe punishes us and brings onto our senses the particular odor of that void. The Milky Way is a burning star that fell from its foundation, setting on fire the space through which it passed. And do not eat beans, lest you repeat the Milky Way in your very own guts. Bean is the model of the universe itself. It angers the universe that we eat its model, digest its geometry. But do not eat beans, for you will tamper with the form of things. You will upset the zones, Arctic zone, equinoctial, winter solstice, Antarctic zone. And the zones and angles will collide inside you, and the broken parts team up to form an active and explosive spirit stamped with the scent of your inner darkness. Fire is 24 right-angled triangles. Air is 48 triangles. Water is 120 triangles. Ether is 12 equilateral pentagons. and our body is a matrimony of these elements. But those who eat beans divorce the elements. And the nose, like the only child of a failed marriage, grieves the separation. Instead of eating beans, we should look up at the sky and wonder at the way things are designed. People should be silent and listen. The universe produces melody, is put together with harmony. But do not eat beans. Never eat beans, for they will produce a counter melody to attack the melody of the stars. When you eat a bean, you eat the universe's soul, and many of you can testify to the soul's existence, for you have often eaten beans and then expelled the soul into the air. It is undignified for the soul of the universe to have to re-emerge into the world, shabbily wrapped in our internal smell. If one chews a bean to the pulp and then exposes it to the sun, it gives out the odor of human seed. If you moisten a flowering bean in a pitcher of water, then bury it in the earth, and after a few days you dig it up again, you'll see that it has the form of a womb. If you look at it closely, you'll find the head of a child growing. So never eat beans, never eat beans. From the moon upwards, things are immortal. Be like the sky, for the sky is good. The stars do not eat beans, neither does the moon. It is inhabited by animals, plants, greater and more beautiful than our own, for the moon animals are 15 times as powerful as the Earth's, not having any sort of smell or excrement. And their day is 15 times as long as ours. Do not eat or sacrifice animals. Do not drink strong spirits. Remain silent and do not eat beans. And death shall have no more dominion over thee. Thank you.
Alexandra is very tall, so I'm just going to leave this here. That was wild and wacky and brilliant and crazy and surreal and dada and ridiculous and profound. Thank you. So welcome, Alexandra. I'm not reading the bios because we don't actually have a lot of time, but the bios are all on the YouTube page at the Facebook group. And I always have a blog post where I have all the photographs and the video, and I always post everybody's bios there. I'd like to welcome Alexandra. She knew Leonard Cohen, so I thought she was just the perfect person to come and share some poems and perhaps memories about this icon. Amazing man, absolutely amazing. Welcome.
So, thank you very much for this opportunity. I'm going to tell you a story in prose and in poetry. And forgive my self-indulgence, the main protagonist of the story is me. This afternoon's story begins in Montreal in the autumn of 1978. I've recently left my psychologically abusive Orthodox Jewish husband of 3 years. I'm 25, and my heart yearns for freedom and love. The apartment I live in is unpleasant, so I painted everything pink to make it bearable, including the bathtub. The bleach-black walls of the old building's hallways and stairway glare at me in silent, violent, lurid green. The lady who lives below me on the second floor frequently and unreasonably bangs on her ceiling at me with a broomstick for disturbing her. She intimidates the hell out of me. I worked as an esthetician back then, and one of my clients who had become a friend invited me to her birthday party. Her beau, Barry, spotted me and basically became besotted. He wrote me poems and found out where I worked. The most intriguing thing for me was his Leonard Cohen obsession. I'd been an ardent Leonard Cohen fan since the age of 15. My friends used to ask me why I listened to such depressing music, but I loved it. Barry had actually met the great and famous bard and even painstakingly learned to copy his handwriting. so Barry's poems about me looked as though Leonard Cohen had written them. This attention was terribly flattering after my ex-husband's total lack of romanticism, and my girlfriend didn't mind, so Barry and I became lovers for all of 5 weeks. Towards the end of our liaison, the facade slipped, and I saw clearly we were not lovers at all. We were just having sex with each other. Zut alors. Incommunicado. And so we mate, but don't communicate. Meeting each other at the same place, we just lose face, because we only give to take, faking what we cannot make. New Year's Day in 1979 found me in a room at the swanky Four Seasons Hotel. I thought I'd died and gone to heaven. I was in that room with Bob DiSalvio, the charismatic owner of a bar in historic old Montreal that was the nightclub for those with creative, individualist leanings. I'd heard of the place, and when Barry took me there, I immediately loved everything about it. Night Magic, named after a line in Van Morrison's Moondance, stood on Rue Saint-Paul, a street that dates from the 17th century. Although old Montreal was originally the city's financial and business hub, by this time, hardly anyone went there at night. In the winter, when a deep white carpet of snow blanketed everything, I felt like a solitary time traveler. The wooden door to the club stood closed and solid between centuries-old thick stone walls. Once opened by the doorman, an irresistible world of artistic people mingling among candlelight and vases of fresh-cut flowers revealed itself. Wonderfully eclectic music played and beautiful decor, complete with antique chairs and couches and old rose satin parachutes suspended artfully from the ceiling and a working fireplace in the back room. And Bob, whose name was the plainest thing about him. The man had an aura of gorgeous, sexy mystery about him, and if he liked you, he called you Angel. He was quite a bit shorter than me. I'm 5'11", most men are shorter than me, but I didn't care. I was smitten. Plus, he asked me to work at his club a couple of nights a week as a manager. This worked out very well, because basically I got paid to go to a club that I would have gone to hang out in anyway. New Year's Eve, 1978, saw a big party in a club somewhere downtown. I was next to Bob at the bar, and my dream was coming true. He was paying attention to me, and only me. He offered me cocaine. When I said I didn't know how to take it, he asked with surprise if this was really true. When I confirmed my innocence, he showed me how to snort it. I also took quaaludes that night for the first time. It was quite a party. Later that night, we ended up at Night Magic. Bob's friend, Leonard Cohen, was there. Leonard Cohen. Closing time came at 3 a.m., and eventually the customers left. A select few of us remained for a private party. Leonard sang for us. I was so stoned on the coke, lewds, drinks, and hash I'd smoked that night, my usual shyness didn't matter. I sang together with Leonard, to songs I'd listened to over and over as a teenager in the front room of my parents' suburban house in London. I even reminded him of the words at one point when he forgot them. It was a perfect night. One of the songs we sang together was "That's No Way to Say Goodbye." I didn't know it then, but years later those words proved to be prophetic. Bob lived above the cobblestones of Rue Saint-Paul in a wonderful, huge, arty loft of brick, massive wood beams, and high ceilings. He occasionally succumbed to periods of great physical weakness and lassitude, reminiscent of a picture he had there of a man from an earlier century, positioned gracefully in a permanent state of exhaustion on a chaise longue. In my mind, the beautiful man in the picture was the mad and wonderful English romantic poet, Percy Bysshe Shelley, but I never found that out for sure. For you. You always come looking for me when you're doped or stoned to tell me how beautiful I am and how I'm going to kill you with my body. Not true. But my body will still be around, a temple to someone else's lust, years after you have expired, gracefully, like the poet in the picture on your wall. Things changed between Bob and I. The man I was besotted with wasn't mine alone after all. Longing for him, I sat at the bar at Night Magic, giddily numbed by the French champagne other men bought to drink with me. The champagne girl with the faraway eyes. The champagne girl with the faraway eyes will drink and drink while someone else buys. Then she smiles at them nicely and walks away, leaving them wondering as they pay. She knows as she sits there where she'd rather be, and who, as she's talking, she'd rather see. But he can't always be there, and so she tries to drown her mind somehow with other guys. But the bubbles burst, and the dreams fade away, and tomorrow she'll drag through another day. But for now, there's this sham and the pain in the glass, and she needs it to maintain this horrible farce. I had a young friend whom I met smoking a joint in the ladies' room one night. When we were introduced, his pale blue eyes seemed to say, "There you are." He was 17, the same height as me, very slim, with light brown curly hair that framed the face of an angel. Although he was a dealer, he was sweet-natured and generous with his hash. Everyone knew he had a thing about me. One night after we'd been friends for a year, we fell in love. He moved in with me the next day. When you dance. When you dance with your lover, touch him slowly and softly in secret places. What he gives you is for no other, and he'll remember. You'll never forget his youth and your beauty united forever, turning time around, turning heads around. In years to come, you may be wiser, richer, even happier. Will you think then that perhaps it's because you touched his soul gently? But Greg started playing with heroin soon after the beginning of our relationship. He treated it like it was a new candy, and therefore so did I. It was part of the perpetual party. I snorted it about a dozen times too many for my fragile psyche. But he liked it, and so did the bad friends he hung with. It didn't take long before he changed, for the very much worse. Life. Life can be like a red balloon, blown up in the shape of a heart. You reach out your hand to touch it, and it blows itself all apart. It didn't take too long before heroin had taken over his life. When I confided in a friend from Night Magic, she looked me straight in the eye and said, "Don't walk away, run." Two bags and a midnight train. Four Seasons Hotel, Montreal. Nice room. My boyfriend, the drug dealer, has made a big score. I hate this scene and how he's become. I'm gonna run away. Champagne from room service. This is not my dream anymore. When my boyfriend leaves the room, I slip some downers into his glass. He returns. He drinks. I wait. He falls asleep. I move quickly. Go to the closet for my coat. See his money piled there. Dirty money. Leave it. Leave him. Leave Montreal. But I can't leave myself. And I ran away to Toronto. But Greg followed me. In fact, he was waiting for me next morning at Union Station when I got off the train. I couldn't believe my eyes. Somehow he'd found out my plan and flew in on a plane to talk me out of it. And so we got back together, because we may have been two messed up young people, but we also loved each other very much. I stayed in Toronto to pursue my modeling career, and he helped me out by sending me money, which I happily accepted, along with the fur coat he gave me for Christmas. And at first it seemed that things were better, much better. But then, bathroom love. You nodded out in my bathroom after you shot the poison into your vein. I didn't even know until our friend told me later, and you were angry with him for breaking your liar's code of never telling the truth. At night, when we were alone in my room with high-rise lights blinking around us, You burst out of the bathroom, wearing underpants and a false smile of bravado. For you were a 21-year-old boy who couldn't get a hard on. The poison had sucked you dry. At the end of the weekend, you returned to Montreal, but you left your smack energy behind in my room, and I sat in it and went mad with the blinking high-rise lights around me. Greg was out of control and I was out of hope. This time I ran away from Toronto back to Montreal. Toronto was a tough town for an unstable girl with no money, and I thought it would be easier to be poor in Montreal. Besides, I had old friends there. I went out to dinner with Bob one night. He could see I was in bad shape. And since I was now on my own, he thought it would be a good idea for me to get together with his friend Leonard Cohen while he was in town. So I did. Leonard took me out to dinner. I told him all about the sad story of love gone wrong with Greg. We drank a bottle of wine each and became lovers. Secret smile. Yes, I did, Lord. Yes, I did. Very many times, Lord, as a matter of fact. Oh, yes. Leonard Cohen was the most charming man on earth. His charm came from a genuine, ingenuous delight with life. Couple that with old-school, well-raised courtesy and a bad boy's sexual appetite, and you have an irresistible combination. One happy morning after the night before, I took a bath in his sparsely furnished, all-white home on Parc du Portugal off Boulevard Saint-Laurent. I was singing away like a joyous little bird. It didn't hit me until about 30 years later that the song I was taking so much pleasure in singing at the top of my voice was Bob Dylan's She Belongs to Me. So I was sitting in Leonard Cohen's bathtub, enthusiastically singing a Bob Dylan song. Leonard never said a word. And he helped me. I had nothing to write with. I'd left behind my modern typewriter along with everything else I owned when I ran away to Toronto the year before. Leonard gave me the first typewriter he ever had. His parents gave it to him and his sister to share when they were kids. I don't know if it came from the 1930s or 1940s, but it still worked perfectly. So there I was, using the same typewriter the man I held to be a literary genius started out using. Leonard had to attend an event at the Sheraton Hotel in Toronto, where he was being honored, quite rightly, for his writing. He flew me there with him so I could pick up my poetry and some other things from the one-room apartment I still had there. As we walked together through the airport in Montreal, I became aware of a familiar, unpleasant smell, the pungent cigarillos that Greg's businessman father smoked. Without looking around, I knew with all my being that his father was there in the airport and had seen me with Leonard. And as I found out later, I was right. How utterly bizarre. Soon I brought my few possessions back to Montreal, stored them, and moved into the bedroom of, or the spare room, of an African-American male friend of mine in an old, dark, and kind of spooky stone building. Or maybe it was the friend who was kind of spooky. I vaguely remember coming home late one night and finding guns and knives in the place and something that looked like a voodoo arrangement strewn across my pillow. Anyway, this friend kept telling me that Leonard was just using me and I should stop seeing him. I was only months away from a nervous breakdown and my dangerously porous mind drank this in, unfortunately. Leonard came to pick me up in a cab one night. We went out to dinner, talked, ate and drank, went back to his place and smoked a joint, and I told him I wasn't going to sleep with him anymore. It was as if somebody pulled a switch. The charm and courtesy vanished, and he abruptly told me to find my own way home. So I walked all the way, as I didn't have any money, and I never heard from him again. It seemed my voodoo friend was right. Give me love. Give me love. Don't give me lust. That's what makes us turn to dust before we're dead. Oh, before we're dead. Years later, in 1990, I wrote this poem. Flowers for Cohen. Ah, Leonard, with your black suits and your black hair and your black heart of gold. The world will not be surprised one day to be told that I, too, have known you. Known your taxi cab, your Air Canada airplane, your bed, and your kindness dispensed like charity with no refund. But then there's the matter of the gift of your typewriter, the one you had shared with your sister, your first original typewriter, old and black and hallowed to me. I used it well, if briefly. The last words I made it write were of lust. Appropriate, wouldn't you say? Then one day I came home and found 1,000 splintered pieces scattered across the room, mangled fragments of our misspent moments, smashed by my jealous, junky boyfriend. Appropriate, wouldn't you say? I'm sorry to say I bore a grudge against Leonard Cohen for the way we ended, for a very, very long time. And I'm happy to say that I finally let go of it this August, completely. I found understanding for him and closure with him within my heart. And now he is gone. His beautiful voice will make new words no longer. How glad I am that he became such a lovely, gentle man, a real mensch. What radiant energy he takes on to his next life, and what a difference he made to this one. Homage to a poet. And the angel with the broken wings, how bittersweetly does he sing. Sincerely, A. Innes. Rejoice, Montreal, for your son, S-O-N, is risen. Thank you.
Wow, I don't think Alexandra has ever told that whole story till now.
Thanks to you.
Oh, thank you. Wow. There's no words. And I always have a lot of words. So thank you so much for sharing and it's a really unified piece of writing. I really like the prose and the poetry. And it's very much from the heart. And my word, you've been through a lot. So thank you. And now we have our featured writer, Lisa Dean Nikolits. Did I say that right? She's a prolific author, she's a brilliant author, she writes novels, so she's a prose writer. And I've only read one of her books, The Nearly Girl. It was terrific. I started reading, I couldn't put it down. You know, that was it, you know, it was just sit there for hours. It was, she writes with insight. There's some satire there, but it's done with such a gentle hand. And there's a great sympathy for each one of her characters, even the ones that you maybe wouldn't like. She manages somehow to present the viewpoint of a whole group of characters, and we're sympathetic towards them. It's a remarkable talent. So welcome, Lisa.
Yeah, I'm remarkably shorter than most of the readers. So. That was incredible. I kind of, it's difficult to now move into The Nearly Girl because I feel so transported by that. That was really, really fantastic. I'm going to read two pieces from The Nearly Girl. And a lot of The Nearly Girl was really motivated by the Toronto poetry scene. And I'm really, really delighted to be here today. So thank you, Brenda, for having me. And I too love the Toronto Public Library, so thank you. So part one is about Henry, and Henry is my protagonist's father, and Henry is a poet. And Henry's, you know, not quite right. The book was published in spring, and it was memorable for two things: Henry's spectacular meltdown and Meghan's realization that she was pregnant. Shortly before the launch, Henry's behavior became increasingly erratic. But how can you tell when he's never done things the normal way? Meghan's mother asked recently. Because there's a normal, even for Henry, and this isn't it. Are you and Dad going to come to the launch? Of course we are, and maybe we can take the two of you out for supper before or after. Meghan sighed. I've got no idea, Mum. I'd love to, but to tell you the truth, I've been feeling so exhausted lately. I've been trying to get more sleep, but it isn't easy. And it was then that she recalled her two missed periods, but she pushed the thoughts away from her mind. Maybe things will get back to what they were once the launch is over, she said hopefully. I'm sure they will, her mother agreed. Are Henry's parents coming? I don't think they even know about the book. He said you two are more like parents to him than his ever were. Oh, Mum, I don't have a good feeling. I've been smoking too much and I feel sick all the time. I must cut down and eat better. I just feel like throwing up. You're not pregnant, are you? Her mother asked jokingly, and Meghan went cold. Of course not, she said heartily. I'm just not taking good care of myself. But I will, though, once the launch is over. Launch night arrived, and Henry was nowhere to be seen. Is he coming? The editor asked Meghan an hour after the event had started. Meghan shrugged. I can't tell you, she said. You know Henry. I thought this meant something to him, the editor snapped, and he was angry. It's important that he be here. We need him. Well, Meghan repeated, you know Henry. And Henry chose that moment to arrive, and he wasn't in good shape. He was wet and filthy and wild-eyed, and his hair was matted. I found him, Bob said, the one who would be Zimmerman. I know a few of his haunts, and I tracked him down. Which might not have been the best idea, Meghan commented, and the editor agreed. Henry, the editor called out to him, are you up for a reading? But Henry just rolled his eyes at the ceiling and swayed. Meg, is he all right? Meghan's mother arrived at her side with her father in tow. I don't know, Mum, Meghan said, and she sat down. The evening was going where it was going, and all she could do was watch. She drank beer from someone else's glass, and she shrugged when some snotty girl shouted at her. Come on, Henry, the editor urged, and he led the writhing Henry up to the stage. Here he is, the editor announced, our genius poet, here at us. Come on, Henry, honor us with a reading. Henry just stood under the spotlight, swaying, and the whites of his eyes showing. He's always so dramatic, the snotty girl commented, such a drama queen. I just don't understand what all the fuss is about, his so-called brilliance, blah, blah, blah. And Meghan was sorry that she'd finished the beer, or she would have tossed it at the girl, and she looked around, but there wasn't anything else that she could throw. Meanwhile, Henry hadn't progressed from eye-rolling to spouting verse, and Meghan wondered what the editor would do next. And it didn't help that the crowd had picked up a chant. Henry, 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 and Henry shrank back. But then he opened his eyes, and he seemed to focus for a moment, and the editor seized the opportunity to thrust a copy of the book into his hand. Henry turned the book over this way and that, examining it. Read, 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 the crowd chanted, and a small smile crossed Henry's face, and he looked like a child finding that extra present under the tree, which Meghan thought was how he had looked at Christmas when they were all together, and Dad had hidden that last one, especially for him. Henry held the book wonderingly in his hand. And then he tugged at the drawstring of his hospital trousers and he let the filthy garment fall to the floor. He flipped the book open at the center and he took his penis in his hand and proceeded to piss on the pages, carefully drenching the book with yellow urine. A flood fell from the pages and onto the stage. When he had finished, and the piss seemed to go on for a lifetime, he snapped the book shut, spraying those close to him, and he laid it very carefully on the table. And then he pulled up his trousers and tied the drawstring with a neat bow. He closed his eyes and leaned in towards the microphone. The crowd, already silent, didn't move a muscle, and not even a chair creaked. Empty, Henry said, empty. He opened his eyes and he looked at Megan and he pushed through the crowd and made his way out into the night. Genius, my ass, the snotty girl said. Although, the rumors are true, he's hung like a donkey, I'll give him that. And Megan wanted to slap the girl, but she got up and went to the stage instead, and she gingerly picked up the drenched book and dropped it into a small plastic bag she had found in her purse. Come on, she said to her parents, how about we go and get that supper? Are you okay, dear? Her mother asked her. Goodness me, poetry readings have changed since my day. So that is, that's Henry. And Henry actually is proving to be quite a popular character in the book. And I've always loved Henry too, so I'm really glad about that. So now we switch gears and we move from the mid-80s into 2014. And Amelia is now in a therapy group because she nearly gets things right. She doesn't get them right, she gets them nearly right. So she has to go to therapy or she's going to lose her benefits. So imagine you're in a group therapy session. Your therapist looks like Paul Giamatti. His name is Dr. Francis Carroll. And I sort of was calling him eccentric, and then Brenda pointed out that he's actually more psychopathic, which is more accurate. But as Brenda said, we kind of see life from his point of view. I'm sorry, I've lost my place. Where am I here? Right, okay, so here we go. Anyway, enough of that, Dr. Carroll said, and he changed the subject abruptly. There was a lot of violence in this room last week, but wait, where are Whitney and Joanne? Having sex in the toilet, Alexi said morosely. I was nothing to her. I was just sex. I meant nothing. And look at her, a fat housewife, and me. I have such beauty, and he growled to show his manhood and his displeasure. They're still in the washroom? Dr. Carroll looked at his watch. Who's going to go and get them this time? I will, Alexi jumped to his feet, but Dr. Carroll leapt up and blocked his path. Not a good idea, he said. It is time for you to do the opposite thing. I'm sure you want to hit them. I want to kill them. And so you're going to do the opposite thing. You're going to sit down and forgive them and love them and wish them happiness. Look at it this way. You're a spectacular specimen of manhood. You could get any girl you want. Why get hung up on a middle-aged neurotic woman? Because I love her and she loves me. And I thought she would leave her husband and be with me and we would have sex 6 times a day and have babies and be happy. You can be as happy with someone else, Dr. Carroll said. 6 times a day, Shannon said, and she sat up straighter in her chair. The only trouble is, Alexi said, and he pointedly to Shannon, I like blondes. Be blonde next week, maybe we can try. And Shannon looked like she was ready to leave right then and there and go to the nearest hairdresser. Sit down, Shannon, Dr. Carroll said tiredly. I'll go get them, please. Everyone sit still and wait, preferably in silence. Alexi gave a few low growls now and then, while Ainsley told Persephone about how worried she was that someone would cut off her finger in a McDonald's in order to steal her engagement ring. Any luck with the hoarding? Shannon asked Angelina, who sighed. I tried to gather a tiny bag, just one little plastic bag, and fill it with junk and throw it out. It took me 2 days to get the bag filled, and then I couldn't throw it away. I put it in the corner of my bedroom, and I left it there. Yes, but it's good that you tried. Well, that's nice of you to say so, honey, but that's not the truth. I've done that before, and in fact, even better. I can package the stuff up, but I can't give it away. What do you think will happen if you give it away? I feel like I'll go crazy unless I get it back. Angelina, we don't use the expression go crazy, Dr. Carroll said, returning to the room with Whitney and Joanne in tow. We say experience a psychotic break. Yes, well, that's got much more of a sympathetic ring to it, Persephone said. It certainly reassures me. Well, deconstruct the term go crazy, Dr. Carroll said. What do you think it means? It means that your psyche loses touch with reality. In other words, your psyche experiences a breakdown. Going crazy is such a loose phrase. It can encompass so many of the mild and ordinary sins of daily life. Now, he said, I do want to check in with all of you, but first we must meditate. We need to lower the anger level and lower the testosterone in the room. We need to try to dispel our feelings of blame and self-hatred. And to this end, we shall empty our minds and our hearts, and we shall focus upon a lowly piece of fruit. We will engage our energies in studying this mild-mannered unsung hero, the crone of the vineyards, the wrinkled doyen of the magisterial court. Behold, the raisin. I hate raisins, Mike spoke up, and he was soon supported by David, Shannon, Persephone. Oh, come now, Dr. Carroll said with raised eyebrows. Are you not open to new experiences, albeit with old partners? Do not make the mistake in life that each encounter with an individual will be the same. Give your friendships with food and men and women more credence than that. Each time you meet a person, or a dish of food, or even a book you've read many times before, say, hello, new friend, and what lessons can you teach me today? Lexi gave a snort. I sure was surprised last week, he said, glaring at Whitney. She gutted me like a fish, no mercy. That was a surprise. You got that right. Let's move on, Dr. Carroll said. One day, Alexi, you will thank Whitney for what she did. You embraced sex rather than anger, and that was good. But you got too attached to the specific host of the sexual experience, as opposed to discovering that the sexual experience is a transcendent act that unites the yin and yang of our human selves. You need to let go of that attachment. Find the opposite of that, and the opposite of attachment is love and forgiveness, both of which are leading you away from hate, anger, and violence. Do you see how everything is leading you away from anger and hate? Oh, you talk so much, Alexi moaned, his head in his hands. I can't listen to so many words. You are killing me. Well, no more talking, at least for a while, Dr. Carroll assured him. It's time to meditate. Hold out your hand, and everybody try to find new meaning in old things. So thank you very much.
You see, what a great book, you've got to read it. It was just recently published by Ilyana Press. And there's a bunch of copies in the library, but they're all on hold. So thank you so much, Lisa. I enjoy every reading that I've gone to where you've read from this book, too. It's got a lot of layers. And they keep opening out, even, you know, as I... Anyway, we've got one more feature, Steve Paul Sims. And he's going to play for the last half hour. And Steve Paul also plays at Transact once a month on Sundays.
Tomorrow.
I know, I'm always working on the video and I don't make it over there from today. But it's what, 5 to 7?
That's right, exactly, yeah.
5 to 7 at Transac. I have made it a few times though. Yeah. It was nice to go over and have a glass of wine. Steve Paul is a singer-songwriter and you hear his songs a few times, and this guy is quirky and brilliant. He's got songs about meeting at Loblaws, and oh my goodness. Do you know, it's such a... Anyway, I am really, really happy to feature you. And welcome. You're not really quirky.
Quirky is an interesting word.
Do you think they're like love poems at Loblaws?
Well, that's where it begins, yeah. I wasn't going to do that one, but I might now, I guess. I
know. No, you don't have to. He's done it before on open mic, so just do the set.
Sure. Well, my sets are always made up on the spot, but I do have some ideas. What a treat to hear all this stuff. I was going to sit on this, but I think we'll stand for a bit. This one has a little bit of personal history mixed in with it, and it was in the early 1980s. I moved at least 15 times. From Ottawa to Edmonton to Banff to Vancouver, back to Edmonton, back to Ottawa, Sarnia, where my mom was living, and Toronto. So this wasn't written at that time. It was written about 20 years after that, but it's about that. It's called The Wanderer.
82, 35th Avenue, Edmonton, AB. Just 27 years, and in between careers, Edmonton, that's me. I threw my first I Ching. What would the future bring? What was my purpose on this plane? Up came the hexagram, explaining who I am and what I always would remain. And you can call me the wanderer. I'll wander all my days. If you gave all this world to me, you'd never change my ways. So much for sitting still, I feel an act of will snaking up my spine. Let's put things to the test. Let's blow this sleepiness, destiny, you're mine. Heading Toronto way, I'll find a brand new play that's got a character like me. But when I play that scene, I'll jump back in between a riddle and a mystery. And you can call me the wanderer. I'll wander all my days. If you gave all your love to me, you'd never change my ways. Some years were Stony Brook, others went up in smoke. Wheel of life go round. When you've been out at sea, it sure feels good to be back upon dry ground. Now it's clear as a bell, I've learned my lesson well. I get my schooling on the run. Whatever happens next, it isn't in the text. Tell you about it when I'm gone. And you can call me the wanderer. I'll wander all my days. If you gave all this world to me, you'd never change my ways.
There is one reference to a Hare Krishna in it, which of whom you don't see very many anymore. I don't know why.
It's very cold.
Okay. It's called the Queen Streetcar Blues. This is for Celia. Happy birthday, Celia.
I'm not there. There's a girl with one ear that's much bigger than the other. If I don't look away, well, I know I just stare. too, it appears. And a stoic old driver just waits for the green light. Been driving home crazy for 25 years. And a stop comes along and the women get on and make eyes at your chair. And they wonder why you don't get up out of there. So you smile at them nice and get up on your feet. And a 12-year-old metalhead hops in your seat. Blues. You got the Queen Streetcar Blues. I swear that I fell in love 3 times this morning. There was 2 times at Jarvis and 1 back at Bay. And it's always the real thing, it's not just my fancy. But I never can think of the right thing to say. And the stop comes along and she moves to the door. And I get ready to say, hey, haven't we met before? But her eyes stare right through me like I'm not even there. And it soon occurs to me she just doesn't care. I got the Queen Streetcar Blues. I got somebody's bubble gum stuck to my loafers. Someone else breathing garlic right into my face. And I look out ahead and see roadblocks forever. And I thank God this streetcar is running over it. Now the children get on and they try not to pay. But the driver says, nope, I don't work it that way. Hare Krishna gets on and he needs one more quarter. He says, help me. I say, why? He says, don't you think you oughta? The old man's still arguing with his companion. He thinks we should sink the Titanic right now. And the driver steps out for his donut and coffee. It's Wednesday, it's hump day, he'll make it through somehow. Now the baby's crying, needs some affection. But the mama just looks in the other direction. And the girl with one ear that's much bigger than the other, she thinks she might just be the child's natural mother. Blues. They got the Queen Streetcar Blues. I ride the Queen car from Spadina to Sumac. Pull up to a window, pretend I'm not there. But I wouldn't trade it in for the fastest of taxis. When the circus is in town, we got it right here, right here, right here. We got it right here. When the circus is in town, we got it right here.
Anybody know the name Ali Greenwich? Oh. Ali Greenwich was, you know her music if you don't know her name. She was one of the great New York songwriters of the 1960s, and along with her husband at the time, Jeff Barry, and along with Carole King and her husband at the time, and all these different songwriting teams, some of them husband and wife teams, and they came up with all the, Ali Greenwich wrote or co-wrote Be My Baby, Chapel of Love, Leader of the Pack, Then He Kissed Me, River Deep, Mountain High, Da Do Run Run, and Do A Diddy Diddy. So, and I was just reading about that whole Brill Building scene. It was called these two big buildings on Broadway, the Brill Building and another one up the road at 1650 Broadway. And they just churned out hits after hits after hits. And just about the time I was reading about Ellie, she passed away of pneumonia. And so I just was moved to write this song for her. And if it reminds you of any of her tunes, it's quite intentional. Come
say that you would never be my baby. And I could never kiss you in the chapel of love. Do-wah-diddy, your songs still make me giddy. My transistor radio is crying for you. Goodbye, Ellie. Baby, I still love you. Just how much young romance did you write the soundtrack to? But when they all got married, you broke up with Jeff Berry. Did you think to save a little love for you? Lieber Stoller, Goff and King, Neil Diamond and Sedaka, I love them all, but Ellie, you're the leader of the pack. You put the Shangri-Las through all their rooms and eyes. Spectre's wall of sound was built on your melodies. Goodbye, Ellie. Baby, I still love you. Just how much of romance did you write the soundtrack to? But when the songs were ended, where all the broken hearts may be, did you think to save a little love for you? I hear those Broadway pianos ring in cubicles so thrifty. Now were you at the Brill Building or up at 1650? I get the details muddled, but all those nights we cuddled. Is there any way to show you how much I care? Goodbye, baby, I still love you. Just how much young romance did you write the soundtrack to? But when the songs were ended, where all the broken hearts made it, did you think to save a little love for you? Go into the chapel and we're gonna get married. Go into the chapel and we're gonna get married. Keep it going. Be my baby. Gonna get married. Be my baby. Gonna get married.
Thank you. Well, this is a song off one of my CDs. And it's called She's Changing Her Mind Again. This comes in two different versions. Sometimes it's a tango and sometimes it's a waltz. I think we'll have a waltz on it today. She's changing her mind again. Now how many times is that? I feel every now and then, like burning her coat and hand. This time I was sure she'd stay. She'll break down, but who knows when? She's false and she's true, but what can I do? She's changing her mind again. I'm fixing the broken doorbell, feeding the lonesome birds. I'd give anything at all not to fall for the same words. She's changing her mind again. I'm always the last
to know. I stop and I count to 10, but over the edge I go. This time I was taken in, now only the words remain. I've said what I could, it does me no good. She's changing her mind again.
Guitar student of mine, and he's no longer there, and his wife is there. She's a beautiful young woman from Mexico, and they both have plans to move at some point to Mexico and build a home. As the song says, it goes something like this. I'm icing the cake. She's sweeping the coffee aisle. I'm stuck in the bakery. I heard her talking Spanish. Merda, I went and studied Francais. So I bought a dictionary, and it told me what to say. Te quiero, Elizabeth. Te quiero. Te quiero, Elizabeth. Te amo. Te quiero, Elizabeth. Te quiero. Te quiero, Elizabeth. I love you. She majored in business. I guess we're both pretty smart. She gets to my brain, just like she goes to my heart. When you meet somebody new, who knows where it might lead? I got a feeling I like. She's just what I need. quiero, Elisabetta. Te quiero. Te quiero, Elizabeth. Te amo. Te quiero, Elisabetta. Te quiero. Te quiero, Elisabeth. I love you. It's not such a bad job slicing pumpernickel bread. Spend most of my days just writing songs in my head. Then I see her again, so dark and so pretty. And they will build us a home north of Mexico City. Te quiero, Elisabetta. Te quiero. Te quiero, Elisabeth. Te amo. Te quiero, Elisabetta. Te quiero. Te quiero, Elisabeth. I love you. Y para todos los días, y hasta el último de la tierra, I mean to say, I will always love you.
Another song about a famous lady now. This one much better known. She needs no introduction. So this is from my all-time favorite movie star. And let the song take the rest of it. I like to go to the movies. I'm old-fashioned that way. I like to sit in a big dark room in the middle of a blazing August day. Sometimes I have to rent DVDs cause they don't play what I wanna see. From Gobble to Brando to Peter O'Toole, O'Cagney and Edward G. And anything with Ingrid. Anything with Ingrid. Anything with Ingrid. I don't care. Anything with Ingrid. Anything with Ingrid, anything with Ingrid, I'll be there. Now you can keep your seventh seal, cries and whispers too. Ingrid's the only Bergman for me, a moody old man won't do. How can I get to Rick's Cafe on the Orient Express? Have an indiscreet intermezzo at the end of the Six Happiness. Anything with Ingrid. Anything with Ingrid. Anything with Ingrid. I don't care. Anything with Ingrid. Anything with Ingrid. Anything with Ingrid. I'll be there. Turn on the gas light. I feel notorious tonight. And I'm spellbound by your smile. Here's looking at you, kid. It's not so much the things you did, but you did them with such style. Here's to Carrie and Gary and Spencer and Leslie and Bogie and Boye and Bing. Gregory Peck, Tony Perkins, and Quinn, and Yul Brynner, the Siamese king. What a lineup of cinema's luckiest sons and the cream of their fortune by far, is they all got the chance to gaze into the eyes of that bright international star. Anything with Ingrid. Anything with Ingrid. Anything with
Then when Hollywood came to condemn you and America said amen, in greed you carried on living your life till they came to their senses again, raising your beautiful children, acting to save your soul. Just by being yourself, you set such an example. That was your greatest role. Yes. Princess Anastasia on a Roman piazza, with the world's paparazzi at your garden gate. Joan of Arc in a brand new play, you're the toast of the great white way. A photographer's sweetheart, a director's mate. Your papa put you in front of a camera, but the rest of the world kept you there. You keep me pinned to the edge of my seat with that voice and a beauty so rare. I've seen this movie at least 7 times, I could watch it 12 times more. Now for whom do the bells of St. Mary still toll? Tell me when I count to 4, 2, 3, 4. Ingrid. 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 I don't care. Anything with Ingrid. Anything with Ingrid. Anything with Ingrid. I'll be there.
I'll do two more. This is a sing a ballad and then a funny one for Ilyana.
Thank you.
Well, it'll be the funny one. I hope you like. I hope you think it's funny. Another Toronto song.
There's something wrong with your love. It doesn't move me like it should. I don't belong in your love. I'll never do you any good. Maybe some supper at the Shanghai. Maybe some blues down at the shoe. Maybe the memory of too many winter nights can make me reconsider you. To melt away inside those tender arms, some man would sacrifice 10 years. But when I try to feel the way I used to feel, the memory just disappears. There's something wrong with your love. It doesn't move me like it should. I don't belong in your love. I'll never do you any good. Sometimes a lonely man's a wise man, but otherwise he's just a fool. Why would the skid row bumble romance one day just give away a jewel? Here, dry your eyes, I'll pay the waitress. We'll flag a cab out on the street. I'll sleep again on what I've slept these many nights. We'll let the rest be incomplete. There's something wrong. It doesn't move me. I don't belong.
one. A bunch of years ago, I did a play with the Toronto Irish Players, and I don't have a drop of Irish blood in my body. I'm Welsh, which is about as close as it gets, I guess. without being the real thing. Well, there's an old saying, what is a Welshman's an Irishman that can't swim or something. Anyway, but I wrote this, it seemed around the 17th of March, especially in Canada, not in the old countries, but there's this St. Patrick's Day fever, you know, and this song just came out. It was written in about 45 minutes. I think I added one verse later than that, but, and it's got a little chorus that goes, forgive me, please. Goes, and it's green, 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 green. Can you manage that? Yeah, just don't get them in the right order. And the chorus ends, the last line of the chorus is, well, I haven't been in Ireland now for 16 generations, but we'll all roll together in the clover. Thank you for having me here today, and as Brenda mentioned, I will be at the Transat tomorrow at 5, that's just down the road, 292 Brunswick, for 2 whole hours with my little band. And next Saturday, this time next, just about exactly, I'll be at another Poetry and Music Salon on Vino Rosso. I'll be the music feature there. That's a Bay Street, 995 Bay Street. This is Green, Green, Green. Thank you, and have a good afternoon. Well, I haven't been in Ireland now for 16 generations, but you never ever know it from the way I tip me hats. I'm a jolly jumping leprechaun, I drink the hearts of all that rum. Begorra, I'm hungover in the morning. Well, my name is Dan McGuire, I'm a poet and a liar. I can tell you 50 stories about me dear old Uncle Jim. He's a hero in the army, if you buy that load of Blarney, they'll tell you the truth, I made him up entirely. And it's green, 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 green. Well, I haven't been in Ireland now for 16 generations, but we'll all roll together in the clover. Well, I know she's two-thirds Métis, but the rest of hers is Irish as the shamrock in your eye. Though she always makes a furor when I sing to Laura Laura, she can drink a bloody fish under the table. Well, I've never been to Dublin where the beer is always bubbling, but what difference does it make if Capuscasin is me home? If there's anyone complaining, I dispatch their bloody brain in, and they wish they never heard the name Maguire. And they scream, green, 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 green. Well, I haven't been in Ireland now for 16 generations, but we'll all roll together in the clover. It's the 17th of March again, and Danny Boy is parched again. The pubs are never open to business early enough for me. When they crack the bottle on me head, don't let the devil know I'm dead. And make sure that me Irish eyes are smiling. And it's green, 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 green. Well, I haven't been in Ireland now for 16 generations, but we'll all roll together in the once again. And it's green, 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 green. Well, I haven't been in Ireland now for 16 generations. But we all grow together in the cold.
Casual, drop by, have a drink, listen. It's It's lovely. It's pretty much across the street. It's just on the other side of Bathurst. So thank you so much for coming out. Thank you to all the people who came, stepped up to the mic and shared their work, and to our features, Lisa and Alex and Steve Paul. And the next salon is the last Saturday in January, and it's going to be LGBTQ themed. I have two beautiful friends of mine who are poets and artists and actors and directors and playwrights, Philip Cairns and David Bateman, will be featuring, and because they're artists, I want a video. They promised to do video, as well as Nikki Ward. She is amazing, and she's also an artist. And then at the end of February, I've got the two Allens, the fathers of the art bar. So Alan Griesmaster and Alan Soderberg, and they have also been invited to do a video performance while they're reading. So I think Alan Soderberg's, he's an artist anyway. And Holly Griesmaster is going to do the video of her work while Alan reads. So do keep the salon on your calendar. In May, we want to do a fundraiser and have a fabulous festival season. And thank you, I love you all.